when there's a concern among sources that their identities could be disclosed through suspicionless searches, they're going to be less likely to be sources. And so there's a chill on news gathering, and there's a chill on the free flow of information to the public.
I'm Justin Silverman of the New England First Amendment Coalition. Quick note, on September 25th, I'll be moderating a panel discussion about how to access government data on the COVID-19 pandemic. I'll be joined by a number of health experts, journalists, media attorneys. It's all part of the 2020 FOI Summit brought to you by the National Freedom of Information Coalition. I encourage everyone to attend. It'll be a very useful, helpful conversation. You can get more details about that discussion as well as other summit events at nfoic.org. Or as always, you can subscribe to nefac.org and get all the details about our upcoming events and presentations. I'm here today with Gabe Rotman, who is the Technology and Press Freedom Project Director for the Reporters Committee for Freedom of the Press. Gabe, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So Gabe and his colleagues at the Reporters Committee have led an amicus brief effort in a case called Al-Assad v. Wolf, which is currently being heard by the First Circuit Court of Appeals. The case involves a number of First Amendment issues pertaining to the government surveillance and searching of electronic devices at the border. Think journalists being flown in or covering a news story at the border, their laptops, their phones being searched. Gabe is going to help us sort through these First Amendment issues and give us a better understanding of what's at stake in this case. But first, Gabe, if you could you take us back and tell us the facts of the case and all the circumstances leading up to this amicus effort?
Sure. So this is a civil case that was brought by the ACLU is litigating the case on behalf of I believe around 10 citizens and one permanent resident, all of whom had their electronic devices searched at the border. Some of them had the devices kept for long periods of time, and none of whom were charged with a crime or faced any consequences afterwards. And it's a civil case, but it's challenging what's called the border search exception in Fourth Amendment law, which isn't exactly an exception. Under the Fourth Amendment, searches have to be reasonable. And the Fourth Amendment usually says that when you have a warrant, that a warrant based on probable cause, the search is reasonable. The border search exception is a line of cases that basically holds that when authorities at the border are fulfilling their immigration or customs enforcement responsibilities, they can search devices without any suspicion because that particular context makes those searches reasonable. And with the growth and all of us having smartphones in our pockets and potentially lifetimes worth of data in those devices, accessible through those devices, the stakes of these suspicionless searches have become significantly higher in recent years.
So tell me a little bit more about those stakes. I mean, really break it down for us when it comes to being a journalist, for example, being at the border. What are the risks here? Why should we be concerned as First Amendment advocates about the searching of devices at the border?
Mm-hmm. I think there's probably two, for journalists specifically, I think there's two things. And it's the same, these are the same concerns that you get when you're talking about, any other surveillance regime that doesn't have an appropriate level, an appropriate suspicion requirement. In other words, that doesn't require law enforcement to show that that they have a reasonable expectation that somebody's engaged in wrongdoing. In all of those cases, we have the same kinds of issues that come up. But basically, I would say there are two. One is, and they're related. One is reporter source confidentiality protections. If you're carrying an electronic device across the border and you haven't appropriately scrubbed it of sensitive information about stories that you're covering, about people that you're speaking to, searches of those devices can disclose the identity of sources who wish to remain anonymous. You know, that's a direct concern for, it's a direct concern for the sources. It's a direct concern for journalists. And then the other argument, this is the argument that the Reporters Committee and the Koamiki made in the recent amicus brief. The other issue is that when there's a concern among sources that their identities could be disclosed through suspicionless searches, they're going to be less likely to be sources. And so there's a chill on news gathering and there's a chill on the free flow of information to the public. And so those two interrelated concerns are really what's at issue when you don't have a basic get a warrant requirement, which is what is needed here.
Got it. So what advice would you have for journalists specifically at the border as this case is making its way through the courts? How should journalists best proceed to not only protect themselves, but their sources as well?
Do as you've been, so first of all, be aware of the law here and the fact that there is broad discretion granted to immigration and customs authorities as you're crossing international borders. Your devices can be searched. There definitely know your rights in terms of what you can do, what you can't do when you're crossing international borders. There's plenty of know your rights material available. The ACLU has great resources on that. Effectively, if you're a U.S. citizen, they can't keep you from crossing the border, but they can detain you for significant periods of time if you don't want to hand over your device. And if you're not a U.S. citizen, they can bar entry into the country. So for all of those, so definitely know your rights as you're crossing international borders, be cognizant of that potential, but then also being cognizant of that potential, you can take steps yourself. So use encrypted applications on electronic devices, truly sensitive material, just don't have it, stored on your computer or your cell phone as you're crossing international borders. If you have applications that can access it in the cloud, you can delete them and reinstall them when you're crossing the border. In a lot of ways, and it's the same with cybersecurity generally. Think about your threat profile. Think about the potential sensitivity of what you're carrying with you and ensure that, even if your device is searched, that information can't be disclosed.
Now, these are great suggestions and tips for journalists, but we have a number of non-journalists that will be, watching this video, and many of them might be thinking, okay, why should I be concerned about this? How does this apply to me? Why should I care? What would you say to them?
Yeah, I mean, the case, the underlying case that we're talking about, Al Assad, is the individuals aren't journalists. They're ordinary citizens who cross the border and have their electronic devices searched without without any suspicion, without any indication that they were engaged in wrongdoing. And the rules for journalists, the stakes are specific for journalists because of the need for reporter source confidentiality and ensuring and being able to credibly say to sources that you will do everything in your power to keep their identity secret. That's certainly applicable to journalists, but more broadly with non-journalists, when you're crossing the border, if you're crossing the border with electronic devices that are going to be searched, particularly if you're engaged in political activity or other types of social interactions when you're overseas, if you're concerned that that activity could lead to scrutiny by the government, you're going to be less likely to engage in that activity. But more broadly, it also, for individuals who are crossing the border who don't understand that this can happen, I mean, it's highly invasive and it's not justified by, a credible indication on the part of law enforcement that you've done anything wrong. And that's not what the Fourth Amendment says, and it's not what the Constitution's in place to protect against.
So let's talk about that just a bit more generally, because, the border is, it's different, right? The government does have more power at the border, generally, under the Constitution. Can you help us understand a little bit more where the lines are as far as what powers government has at the border that they may not necessarily have within other parts of the country as it pertains to the First Amendment specifically?
Yeah, this is the Supreme Court when it recognized the sort of border search exception. I think one thing that is key to understand is while there may be While there may be context, well, the context of the border may be slightly different. Really, what we're talking about here is the context not being different in the digital age. In other words, right now we're talking about a world where, you know, they can search, if you go back 20 years, they'll search your camera bag or something like that, right? Or, you know, maybe they'll search your laptop. You know, under the current state of the art with modern technology, your electronic device is going to hold, you know, far more information. It can access, you know, vast amounts of information, you know, in the cloud, on the internet, and hence it's the electronic device search, particularly a forensic electronic device search, in other words, where they actually go in and you know, take an image of the data that's on the phone, is far more invasive and far more revelatory about, you know, your personal activity. Or again, if you're a journalist, you know, all the stories you're working on, all the sources that you're working with. And so it's that, it's the increase in how revelatory of your personal activity these types of searches are that requires a different analysis here. So the rationale behind the border exception kind of breaks down when you're talking about the scope of information at play and the potential harm from searches that aren't based on you know, a reasonable level of suspicion that somebody's engaged in wrongdoing.
Right. No, it's incredibly helpful to make note of. We're not talking about just reporters' notes and photos here. We're talking about an individual's entire life, all in this one device that can be searched. Thank you for all of this. The amicus brief, which NEFAC joined in support, can be read at NEFAC.org. Where can people learn more about the Reporters Committee and the work that you do, Gabe?
RCFP.org is our website. You know, please go to it. And actually, the project that I direct, at the Reporters Committee, the Technology and Press Freedom Project, we put out a weekly newsletter every week that highlight developments very much like the filing of our brief in Al-Assad and other issues that are relevant to the intersection of technology and press freedom. So we focus heavily on reporter source confidentiality protections, content moderation and regulation online, and lots of other good stuff. So please go to our website, rcfp.org, and sign up for my newsletter.
Excellent. I would second that. I've been a loyal subscriber for many months. It's a great resource, a great read every week. So I'd encourage everyone to subscribe, as well as subscribe at NEFAC.org and to our YouTube channel at No New England. Gabe, thank you again for your time. Very helpful. Appreciate you working us through all of these issues and helping us better understand this case.
Absolutely. Thanks so much, Justin.